Dave Menz, 22-year military veteran and currently state president of APPVA, Australian Peacekeeper Peacemakers Veterans Association Victoria branch. Joined the army initially in 1979 as a reservist, did 2 years in the reserves. After that, 1981 January, I joined the regular army. As always, progressed through the ranks. Various postings from Army Watercraft to Armoured Unit, 1st Armoured Regiment with tanks, engineer units, SIG units, area workshops, that type of thing. And 2 overseas postings, Cambodia 92-93 for 13 months with the Force Communications Unit, United Nations Transitional Authority of Cambodia, and also to East Timor, United Nations Mission in support of East Timor. So when I first joined, we had the old Series 2 Land Rovers, so we drove those. We had the international trucks. We had the commercial line vehicles with the old combis. Best one was the Mini Moke we used to drive. They were good. Across the Sydney Harbour Bridge when it was windy. That was fun. That was a watercraft unit. We had LCMHs, landing craft from ship to shore. We had forklifts. I've driven those. When I was at One Armoured, we drove the carriers, the troop load carrier, the TLCs. They're just like an APC, but they got like a canvas back, so they're a utility vehicle, basically. I was fortunate enough to be able to drive the ARB and the Leopard tank, and I was even allowed once to drive the what we call the bridge layer. That was scary, but it was good fun. When we were with the engineers, we did demolitions. They taught us demolitions, and they also taught us about explosives and all that. And with my experience from the reserves with an engineer unit, I was fortunate enough back then to do the advanced booby trap course. I fired nearly every weapon in the Australian Army, from 9mm pistol, the SLR rifles, the M60 machine gun, the F-88 Stiers, the Minimise, the Mag-58s, I fired the MG-3 machine gun off the Leopard tank, 50 caliber, 30 caliber machine guns, even fired the 105 out of a Leopard tank, and I've also fired the 106 recoilless rifle off the back of a Series 2A Land Rover. So it's been fun. Had some good times. Bang bangs are fun. Friends for life. Not like in Civilian Street. You have friends in Civvy Street, which are friends. Military friends are far more mates, more family than friends. And in the service overseas, Cambodia example, we're over there to assist with fair and just elections, and that happened in May 93. The country's supposed to be fair and just now with Prime Minister Hun Sen. Unfortunately, that's a double-edged sword, unfortunately. It's grown vastly, the economics over there, the shopping climates. Stores are built, people can see their future now, kids have got more schooling, and some of the government agencies are fair. When I got out, I was forced out of the army due to an injury, and then I picked up a job as a contractor for several companies, different times, plus an Australian Public Service. I worked there for a while, assisting with the bringing on new vehicles for the military, replace the Land Rovers, Unimogs, that sort of thing. Best thing I've done though is volunteering for our association, being State Vice President, Secretary, now State President. We actually run the Aussie Veterans Op Shop here in Boronia. We have 2 stores. And we also have the Veterans Advocacy Centre, which we're in now. this centre, we were able to generate, due to the funds that we raised out of the Aussie Vets Op Shop. This is used for supporting veterans. They can come in for welfare support, have a chat, coffee or tea, whatever they want. And we also do, we have advocates here for more levels, up to level 4. And we can do veterans claims through the Department of Veterans Affairs so they get what they're entitled to. And that's the idea. With the op shop, we are well supported within the local and wider community. We not only sell good gear at very reasonable prices, we also have a food bank downstairs which was set up by one of our members. The local community can come in, they can get free frozen meals if they need it. That's not just for military members, that's for anyone. They can come and get free meals. So it gives people assistance if they need it. We have an amazing amount of volunteers, both ex-military and civilian. So it's not a person, it's a team. So we're very lucky where we are. And in fact, we are the only state that does generate their own funds. We don't have to go begging to the government for money as such, but we can if we need to. Everyone can do that through best funding. But at the moment, we're able to get by the way we are and support the veterans, because that's our primary goal, supporting the veterans, nothing else. Supporting the local people, that is also there, but primary veteran support. Anyone from current deployments, way back to Vietnam, we've had Korean veterans we've helped. And currently we also have a 98-year-old World War II veteran we're looking after. And that's amazing, because we have this gentleman who's was in the RAF during World War II, and he comes to us not only for assistance, but he comes to us for a chat now and then. And that's all they love. Everyone comes into the shop, all they want to do is have a chat to us and just talk. And that's military plus civilians. Be sure you want to do it first. That'll be the first thing. Do your research, find out what you may have to do. You may have to deploy. Find out what trade, if you're going to have a trade, what you want to be able to do, where you're going to go. And also, don't think if you join in Melbourne, you're going to remain in Melbourne for your whole time. Depending on your trade, depends on where you go, where the Army sends you, Navy or Air Force, where they send you. And also, in current times, you may be prepared to go overseas. So be prepared to go overseas. And if you do deploy overseas, 99% of the time you're going to have to carry a weapon. And you'll be taught how to use the weapon. You'll be taught what to do and what not to do. What you are not taught to do is if you have to fire the weapon and you have to, worst case scenario, you have to hurt someone, you're not really taught that well how to look after yourself afterwards. Now, you may not have that issue straight away after firing the weapon. It may be a week, month, years, whatever down the track. You also got to be prepared that when people point weapons at you, whether you're going to have to return or whether you're going to have to judge the situation and decide, it hasn't escalated to the point that I need to fire my weapon, even though this person's pointing a rocket-propelled grenade at me with his finger on the trigger. If you do deploy and you do come back and you have issues, whether it be physically or most likely mentally, PTSD, you need to be able to put your hand up and say to someone, I'm having an issue. Now, whether that be to your partner, whether it be to a psychologist, psychiatrist, most likely and most and preferably I would suggest speak to a military friend, one of your brothers, sisters in arms, because chances are they're probably having the same issue as you, and they probably understand what you're going through. Now, the old days, there used to be a case of harden up, buttercup, you know, take a cup of cement and harden up or whatever. But these days, a lot of people do realise PTSD is a serious issue, especially when the amount of suicides we've been having. So rather than bottling it up and then taking the worst action, which is sadly taking your life, because if you do take your life, it's not just you you're affecting, you're affecting your families, your friends, everyone. So please don't take it that far. Before then, put your hand up, say hello to a friend, knock on his door, give him a call. I'm a welfare officer for our association. I've had numerous calls all hours of the night from a veteran and, you know, can I help them? I live in Melbourne Metro and I've driven, you know, anywhere to go help a veteran. I don't care. And that's what we do. So if I can do it in person, great. If I have to do it over the phone, I'll do it. But either way, we'll do it. And if need be, worst case scenario, I can't get there on time, we ring the ambulance service and we ask for a specialist team to go down and assist people. VVCS, Veterans Families Counseling, Vietnam Veterans Families Counseling Service, they're now called Open Arms. They're willing to assist you and they can assist you. And they, most of the time, they do a good job, okay? And there's also Beyond Blue. We all know about them. Lifeline. So I'm not going to tell you to go to which one. Depending on who you are, where you are, you choose. But I would suggest before you go to those, just ring a military brother. Have a chat to a friend, because chances are you're going to open up more to a brother or sister than to a stranger. Military service is totally different than civilian life, and in relation to when you start looking at PTSD issues, we have quite different degrees of problems than a normal civilian person does. So talk to a mate first. Best advice I can give you.